Live.
No, live. We're live. So just to let you know, I trimmed up the intro a little bit by like,
why?
Well, by like 3 seconds, because what I noticed was when we play the intro, hey, Cover to Covered is now live at an event. Yeah, of course. I know. We set this up. Oh, look, we got 3 people already. But I want to explain for those 3 people that the intro may be 2 seconds shorter now. Just because
I'm sure they're going to notice.
They probably won't. Because like when I put the arm on the record, like if you're just listening to it, it's like dead space for like 5 seconds. So I just kind of got sick of it. So I said, all right, well, let me just trim this up a bit as I'm doing today's intro. And since we have 3 people, I guess it's time to do it. Yeah.
Yeah. Let's do it.
All right, here we go.
Cover to Covered is a podcast that features 2 idiots talking about music at length. And occasionally a dog does make an appearance. There will also be special guests from time to time that will show up, and they will be smarter than the hosts. And the hosts will give their opinions. By the way, they are exactly that. Opinions. They are not truths, they are not fallacies, and they do not reflect the views or opinions of their employers or those they employ. So with that, just enjoy the damn show.
So did you all notice how much shorter it was?
I noticed.
It was 2 seconds shorter.
It made a huge difference. I think our subscribers are going to go way up.
Well, yeah, right. Well, right now there's 8 people in here. So, I mean, that's like great to start off the show. I mean, those 2 seconds, you have 2 more seconds to do whatever you want with this right now. And considering the fact that our shows usually go this side of 2 hours, it's valuable. Every bit of it. Welcome again to another high test, high octane,
Well, one thing we have to say, Mike.
What?
It's this true. Behind me, ladies and gentlemen, is it's not, this is not fake.
No, that is real. That is not one of those Zoom backgrounds. That is actually real. And the minute Nick came on, now let's set the scene. Nick and I broadcast from our homes. I'm in San Diego. He's in Detroit. Nick has a partner. His partner has a band. By the way, his partner's name is Jim. And
yeah, right.
Yeah, I'm sure Rachel would hate that. but Rachel has a band. Rachel's an amazing guitar player, and Rachel will be rehearsing at home. So Nick got kicked out of the basement. And I don't know if he necessarily got kicked out. I mean, this is such an improvement over like the Saw movie number 3 background that you usually have when we do these shows. So I am much impressed. If you like this background better, put it in the chat and let Nick know that he should broadcast in there going forward, because that's my vote. I mean, that looks badass, dude.
This is only I'm not exaggerating, people. This is only a third of my collection.
See, that's a third of his collection, and that would be my collection. So, I mean, if that tells you how much he has.
There's four rows behind me that aren't pictured.
Yeah, they're on the bottom.
Yes.
There you go. So welcome to another high test episode of Cover to Covered. My name is Mike Venezia. Nick Morocco is there on the other, well, I was going to say the other side of the country. Yeah, see, look, it's keep the background and much better than the basement. Here's rafters. The thing.
Vaughn and Patrick should count as one vote since they're married. No, they shouldn't matter. Get they're, two no, separate votes.
No, they get 2 votes.
That's ridiculous.
2 votes. Now, Jeff says the location is not going to change the content. The content is fine. It's the problem area, which is our faces.
Mm-hmm.
That's the issue.
Yeah, if you're listening, it's no problem. And if you're listening, this background has no impact on anything.
If you're listening, I look like Brad Pitt. If you're watching, I look like his brother Arm.
Armpit.
Anyway.
I get it.
Hey. Hey, Nick, what store do you own?
Rock City Music Company.
And where are you located?
5 Mile in Farmington, in Livonia.
Where can we find you? Rock
CityMusicCo.com and all social media platforms.
And what is your favorite season?
Fall.
Okay, good. That's the correct answer.
Winter.
Answer is fall. No, that is an incorrect answer.
Let me tell you, it's not the one we're in right now.
Okay, there we go. Fair enough. So welcome to this storied episode of Cover to Cover. This is episode number 49, which means next episode is number
50.
And we're going to try to scram up some special guests to come join us because it's a special episode because it's going to be number 50, and that's a landmark. Why? I don't know. Because people said 50 is good. So whatever. It is.
Maybe
we can
get Gall McCartney.
All right, let's not. I said we want to have special guests, not guests that are special. there's a big difference. So, if they have
that's this, good.
I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to say it because somebody will get angry, and I'm not going to say it. So anyway, so yeah, but this episode is episode 49, which we are previewing Record Store Day 2024,
yes.
Which is this Saturday, April 20th.
420. Yeah, man.
Yeah, man. It's 420, man. Do Cheech and Chong have a record coming out?
They do. There's a reissue of Up in Smoke.
There you go. So it's 420. Yep. Oh, I hear they're rehearsing.
Yes. Is it bleeding through bad?
No, but I hear it.
Yes. Yeah, it's loud.
It's much louder for you. There is a way to fix that if you want to play around with your compression a little bit, but
no, let's listen as they play Jealous Lover.
Yes.
By Rainbow.
And there we have it. Okay, yes. That's great. So
Speaking of Cheech and Chong, I want to show off this Cheech and Chong incense burner I got on deep discount last week because it's Cheech and Chong when they're Alice Bowie, you know, when they do Earache My Eye. It's illustrations. Illustrations.
To me and she show me how to live.
Yeah, it's got the words in the background. Tell me how to live, but I don't listen to her because my head, it's like a sieve. It's on there. $3. That was a must purchase.
Did you only buy one?
There was only one left. But that was a must. Candle with Gene Simmons. And I got Jerry Garcia next to it. Paul Stanley, which is peeling, and a Huckleberry Hound Funko Pop.
Well, there you go. Congratulations. Okay, moving on. So we're going to be talking about what's coming out this Saturday for Record Store Day. There's going to be different types of releases. We'll go through those types of releases. We'll talk about what we feel that we like and name some things that we probably don't like, but you might. And make sure that you get to your store early because what happens, Nick?
Stores sell out of things very quickly.
And are lines forming before you even open?
Lines are always forming. Yeah, it's the earliest we had somebody in line last year was 4 a.m.
Now, here's the big thing. Is everybody who's in line there to actually buy something for themselves?
Oh, well, that's a double-edged sword there, Mike.
Right. So there's a lot of people out there that literally, and look, I used to do this as a kid for concerts. Like I would sleep out, buy tickets for a concert, get like first in line, get the best seats and then sell them just to make a couple of bucks. People do that with records,
yep.
Especially on Record Store Day because they're limited in nature. And next thing you know, it's like they bought it for $20 and it's on eBay later on in the day for $100.
If not more.
They sold out everywhere. Yep. So these things happen. These things happen. So please get to your store early.
Yes.
Bring a cup of coffee.
Rock City opens at 10 a.m. as opposed to our regular 11 a.m. And we're going to have donuts for the people in line from the world famous Looney Baker in Livonia, Michigan.
Nice. There you go. Yeah. The local store by me, which I won't be in town. I actually have to leave for work on Friday. But the local store in town actually supplies IPAs, local IPAs, and if you're of age, and sodas and pizza for those
nice.
That are in line because they have a line that's wrapped around the building twice, you know, so they always take care of their people, which is why I love to shop in that store. So shout out to Record City here in San Diego if you're in the San Diego area. Anyway, so we'll get to Record Store Day in a moment, but I do have a very important question to ask, Nick. How are you?
I'm okay. How are you?
I'm doing okay. What's been going on in D-Town?
What has been going on? Well, the big sadness that happened in the last couple of days is that the Red Wings were right up against it. They were going to make the playoffs. They weren't going to make the playoffs. It kept teetering. And they won the game that they needed to win and then lost or didn't end up going into the playoffs because the other game that was taking place, the worst outcome that could have happened happened. So
like
they
one
got
in a million chance. Came
yes.
In.
Yes. So the Wings are out. So that sucks. But and other
Pistons,
than that,
the Pistons were out around October.
Yeah, they were out like week one of the season. But here's a great thing that happened over the weekend. The store was set up at Astronomicon, which is like a Comic Con thing. Type of pop culture con is more what they call it. It's not a Comic Con. That had tons of special guests and celebrities, wrestlers, little bit of every kind of guest there. And the store was set up there. We had a fantastic time, sold a ton of records, and most importantly, got to meet Kurt Angle. Mike, you're muted.
That's right.
You're muted.
Yeah, I was. So I heard me. That's all I care about. No, as you saw in the intro, I did throw in that picture of you and Goldfish. Goldfish looks like he ate Kurt Angle. But, you know, that's okay. It's okay, Goldfish. Just go for a walk. It's you're allowed to do cardio. It's fine, man. Kurt Angle looked like he was a little scared, you know, and he had hair before the picture was taken and after the picture was taken, he was definitely bald. But I guess the real thing to say is that if you're talking about Kurt Angle, it's true.
It's damn true.
That's right.
And I also got to meet Mick Foley.
Mick Foley is awesome.
Mick Foley is awesome.
Mick Foley is a Long Island guy. So, at least he was, I think he's in Florida now. But
probably.
Yeah. But he was in Long Island for a while, and I rented instruments to his kids.
Nice.
There you go.
Both of those guys were very nice. So
Mick Foley is actually a total sweetheart. I mean, he just really is. He's a genuinely nice dude. I don't know anything about Kurt Angle, but I could speak to Mick Foley being like a really good dude.
So, well, Kurt Angle is an Olympic gold medalist. And Gall McCartney's right. We did meet Rob Van Dam. He was walking around, and he came over to our booth when we yelled his name. And then he looked at the records, and he was like, are these all new? And we said, yeah. And he goes, they're making these again? And we're like, yeah. And he goes, wow, I had no idea. And then he just walked off.
Well, that's called roids.
I think it was a mixture of roids and maybe some roids other substances. Yes, it could have been that too. He was talking to me and Gall McCartney after all.
Yeah, look, my mom has a great comment. Mike muted? Never.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, thanks, Ma. Appreciate it. So anyway, that's awesome. Yeah, over here, things haven't been all that great. I've been sick like the better part of a week. But now finally coming out of it, I feel way better today than I did yet. Like I was feeling really bad last week, and I actually worked from home a couple of days when I normally don't. And then started feeling better on Friday, went to my doctor because I had to anyway, because she wanted to yell at me for a number of reasons. And then Saturday I was feeling much better, and I got invited to go see Billy Joel and Sting at Petco Park, and it poured.
Oh man.
So outdoor concerts in San Diego, you don't think it's going to rain, but it does. I mean, it's rained here pretty much every weekend for the past 2 weeks, 2 months, not 2 weeks. So it poured. Woke up on Sunday not feeling great again. Monday was like, oh no. Tuesday was, oh no. Wednesday was, oh shit. You know, so, but actually, no, today's Wednesday. So it wasn't really, oh shit. It was a lot better today. And I feel a million times better, which is great because I have to get on a plane Friday. The last thing you want to do when you're sick is fly. It sucks.
Yeah, and get everyone else sick like a selfish asshole.
Well, forget about that. I mean, I don't care about anybody else. But no, I mean, I would wear a mask if I felt that bad. But when you're congested and then you go up in a plane and your ears, you know, the ears, you know, do the reverse pop thing, you can't pop them when you land. And then it's just like you it's like you have nature's earplugs for like 3 days until they finally pop after you start feeling better. So I'm thankful for that.
Glad you're feeling better.
Thanks, man. But yeah, Billy Joel and Sting, man, seeing two legends. That was pretty good.
Did he do scenes from an Italian restaurant?
He did scenes from an Italian restaurant.
That's a good one.
And Sting played more Police songs than Sting songs.
Well, that's good. That's a really good thing.
Yeah, but he played Fields of Gold, which was sort of like.
And there were two Fields of Gold. You can't really rile up a stadium with Fields of Gold.
No, it's just, let's go, everybody!
And the Fields of Gold.
And that's pretty much how it was for me. I sat during that one, you know. But yeah, Billy played all the hits, and Sting played all of his hits, and all the Police hits, and it was great because it was the first time in a very long time, and I know you'll understand this, that I went to a concert where I could sing the words to almost every song.
Yeah.
No matter who played, you know, usually like the opener, you're just like, yeah, I know that one song. I've never heard anything else. And then like the headliner comes on, you know, everything. No, I knew everything from both. And it was, and even the new Billy Joel song that he put out.
Great song.
Lights Back On. It's a great tune.
Yeah.
And he played it and it went over well. So good for him. And, you know, 74 years old and he looks every bit of 74 years old. but he's still got the charisma and the musicianship and the voice. Whereas Sting, well, he's got all of that and he looks amazing at 72. As I said, you know, I'm going to be 52 this year. If I look half as good as he does at 72, I'm winning.
Yeah.
You know, damn that guy.
It's all that time. I was going to say it's all that time he spends fucking.
Yeah, the 5-hour sessions or whatever. Anyway, so what are you listening to recently? All right, that's great. That sounds awesome. I have that too.
It's a good one. No, what I've been listening to, you know, I'm always pushing the Atlantic 75th series on here. And this month's shipments were David Crosby's classic, If I Could Only Remember My Name. Amazing album. And a sleeper of a record that I wasn't really familiar with until I got. Well, I had an original press of this because I've had people tell me for years it's a great record. But this 2LP mastered at 45 version of Hall & Oates. Abandoned Luncheonette, great record.
Wow. Okay,
it's good. The big hit everyone knows on it is She's Gone, but yeah. everything else on that record is kind of
like their second album or something.
I believe so. Yeah, it's a little bit more singer songwriter stuff. But there's some rock stuff on there. It's pretty eclectic record, but the pressings of these records just sound so good. They're worth the money. I was talking about the Stone Temple Pilots one on our last episode, which Mike is going to be getting, I think, from me. Acoustic Sounds Analog Productions is just knocking it out of the park on this series, man. This is and the UHQR of Gaucho is on its way to me too, so
nice.
I can't wait to hear that. But even I hate to say it like this, even they're more affordably priced records because the UHQRs are very pricey, but this Atlantic 75 series, which we have them at Rock City as well, these are 2LP sets mastered at 45. I think they sell anywhere between 65 and 75 bucks depending on the title, but fantastic sound quality, definitely get your money's worth. And then the other thing I've been listening to, which we need to take a sidebar and talk about because I've had a bunch of questions about it, and I know a couple of the people that are watching have been waiting for us to talk about this. So a couple weeks ago, the Machine Head, Deep Purple Machine Head 50th anniversary box set was released,
remixed by
Dweezil Zappa. And I should clarify, they're calling it the 50th anniversary set because it's the 50th year of Deep Purple, not the 50th anniversary of Machine Head, because that came out in 1972.
Yeah, they did the same thing with Black Sabbath.
Yes. Yeah. But this was better because it's not Black Sabbath.
Oh, shut up.
But, yeah, so this is a newly remixed version of this classic album, which if you watch this show, you know I just picked it as my favorite album of all time. You get the new mix from Dweezil. You get two live shows and a Blu-ray, which has an Atmos mix of the record, as well as the original 1974 quad mix.
Who did the Atmos mix?
Dweezil.
Oh, Dweezil did that one.
Dweezil did that. So the first thing I want to say before I get into what I think of it is I've already had a ton of people that have come in the store that picked this up that I think they're confused. Okay. This is different than our regular anniversary super deluxe sets that have come out in the last few years. This is a remix. This isn't the classic record recut. This is a full remix. So I've already had a few friends go, oh, Space Truckin' sounds weird, or I never noticed this part in that, and why is Highway Star longer, and things like that. This is a different take on this record. So if you're buying it thinking you're just going to get a new and improved version of Machine Head, you're not. This is a different listening experience. Now, is it better? Is it worse? Is it indifferent? Obviously, that is up to the listener. Okay, for me, it's slightly jarring, okay, because I know the ins and outs of every nuance of this record. So to hear other things show up in the mix, or like I said, the end of Highway Star has an Ian Gillan outro scream that you've never heard, and the solo in I think Maybe I'm a Leo is a different solo. So it's slightly, I don't want to say it just knocks you off kilter, right? Because it's not the same thing that you're used to hearing. However, I do think it sounds great. It's like, it's a good fresh take on this classic record. So it's exciting to hear that. Now, for the people that watch us that are audiophiles, the Atmos was not good. I didn't like it at all. And
all right.
Which is a bummer for me to say, because that was the thing I was really, 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 really looking forward to.
But you know what, though? I mean, when you think about it, when was that album first recorded?
71 into 72.
Okay. So we're talking like 8 to 16 tracks max. You know? I mean, like, how do you do an Atmos mix of that that would be of any real, like, that? I mean, the only thing I could think of would be the keyboards and making them spatialized.
Okay, so that's what I was gonna, well, to answer your first question about how many tracks they were working with and stuff, yes, I get your point, but when you think about Who's Next and Dark Side of the Moon, these are records that were from that same time period. McCartney One, you know, they've been able to do Atmos mixes of those records and have them be successful. This, I think, had the potential to be successful, but it's mixed like a surround sound record. And what I mean by that is the vocals are in the center, the guitar and the bass are left and right, the drums are behind you, and the keyboards are really the thing that swirls around, like you're saying. So like when John Lord kicks into the Highway Star solo and he does that big, you know, slide down the keys, you hear that spin around you, and that's pretty sweet. But other than that, like, what it did for me, the drum sound is not how it sounds on the record. It's definitely been touched up with like a ton of reverb and been modernized. So for me, I didn't like that. Okay. But I will say that the book that comes with this is fantastic. The cut of the LP sounds great. And you do get three other CDs. One disc has the 2024 remix and the original mix, and then two live shows. And at the price point of $80, I think that's super fair considering.
That's a lot of value. That's a lot of value. So I agree. That is a ton of value.
So I still recommend it, but it's not just, you got to realize it's a different experience. It's a different listening thing. It's not hearing the classic record. So if you're into a different take on it, I'd highly recommend it. If you want the same thing, I still would recommend it, but you're going to maybe be disappointed just because it's not exactly what you're used to.
Fair enough. Are your dogs cheering Rachel's band?
I think they're yelling at the rest of the people to get out.
Fair enough. Is practice over?
It sounds like it.
Songs again.
It sounds like it's over.
All right. Well, that was an awesome review. Thank you so much for that, because, you know, inquiring minds always want to know.
Yes.
So, oh wait, I have to call.
And it was very slick. Very slick.
Yeah, very, very slick. Cool. So what I've been listening to, Nick, which you didn't ask.
Sorry.
There were a couple of things. So I finished listening to My Effin' Life by Geddy Lee, the audiobook of his autobiography, which was a great listen. I mean, it really was. Just, you know, when somebody who writes the book actually reads it, it's very hard. There's a bunch of Neil Peart books that have audiobook treatments done to it, not read by Neil.
Yeah.
Like, I kind of want nothing to do with it, because how does this guy know how to put forth the emotion in the voice during certain parts? Like, eh. But Geddy Lee talking about the shit that he wrote makes a lot of sense. And it sounded really, really good. It was a lot of fun to listen to. You can also hear where he was fumbling over words that the ghostwriter put in. You know, the guy who wrote it, you know, like written with Bob Smith or whatever it is.
Bob Williams.
You know, Bob Williams is Fred. And, you know, you could tell like he was reading like a little bit slower. I know they edit these things too, so they try to make it right. But you could tell like he didn't write that like that. He wrote it a different way. And this dude threw in 15 syllable words. So it's kind of fun. But then like Alex Lifeson comes in because
yeah,
he has things that are in the book that are native to him. And then Cliff Bernstein, who's the ones who got him signed to Mercury Records, he's in there, his actual voice reading parts of the audiobook. So it was really, really cool. And then on the audiobook portion, this isn't something that comes with the hardcover book. You get two bonus songs.
Yes.
And there are two songs that were recorded from My Favorite Headache, which was Geddy Lee's solo album. Two songs that he left off that basically are like finished. Like they're finished and mastered and sound great, but he just left them off the album for one reason or another, personal nature. So you get two extra Geddy Lee songs on there. And if you like drums, Matt Cameron was a drummer on that. So it's good to hear Matt.
Yeah, that's right. He brings that up in the book.
Yep. So it's good to hear Matt Cameron playing on somebody else's stuff as well, because he's such an amazing drummer. So Mark Garney's right. Yeah, Dave Grohl's audiobook, Grohl reads it. I mean, it's yes, just that much better. Bruce Dickinson's audiobook, Bruce Dickinson reads it. It's just that much better.
Yes.
Because they're reading their own words and they know how they felt about it. So it works.
If I can make a suggestion in that same vein, the Steve Gorman Black Crowes book is read by Steve. It's not only is it one of the greatest rock books of all time, but the audiobook is even better, because like you're saying, the inflections and when he's telling these stories, it's very much like hearing them directly from him, as if you're sitting in front of him, like sure, the Dave Grohl book.
Yep, exactly. And then other than that, I've been listening to, I wound up getting two box sets over the past month since we were last on. I got, I finally got Led Zeppelin Mothership, and I got Rush in Rio. I did not. It was like one of the live albums, the only live album I didn't have. I had everything else except that.
What'd you pay for Mothership?
You don't want to know.
I do want to know.
I think I paid like $65.
Oh my God, you stole it.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah, I got both of them, including shipping, for like $145 or something.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah. You killed it. Good for you.
Yeah. It's always good to look around for deals sometimes on things like that, especially if somebody's willing to lose money on it. That's not on me. So if you're making 5 points, all right, well, good for you. And free shipping, all right, sure. So anyway, I won't say where, because I don't want to take business away from you. But everything from Nick except the two things I bought.
Yeah, because you're not going to get that kind of deal from me.
No, you're not. with all that said, I was listening to all that stuff that made me very, very happy. But now I forgot where I wanted to go. Oh, I know exactly where I want to go, Nick.
Okay, where?
We're not going to ask. We're not going to do what's coming out this week, because we're
going to. No, we need to. Because there's stuff that comes out on Friday that has nothing to do with Record Store Day.
Yeah, wait, doesn't Taylor Swift come out on Friday?
Yes.
Oh, God. All right, really quickly, what's coming out this week?
Okay.
On Friday.
Pearl Jam, Dark Matter, which also is coming out on record
on
Saturday. They have 6 million variants, including an RSD version. Taylor Swift, Tortured Poets Department, 9 million variants on that one, yeah. Including three. You ready for some breaking news? I'm not supposed to talk about this, but I'm going to talk about it because you know what? Fuck it. That's okay. Why. For the Taylor Swift fans, there are three variants that have been given, well, I shouldn't say given, but sold to independent stores. Okay. Each variant is a different color, different artwork, and has a different bonus track on it. You can only get them from retailers like us. We're not supposed to talk about it until Friday, but you just heard it from me. So there's that. There's the Pearl Jam, which I'm not kidding. I think Pearl Jam and Taylor Swift are in competition for who can have the most variants out at one point. It's absolutely ridiculous. Pearl Jam has like a Chicago variant and a Midwest variant and an Indiana variant and a Target exclusive and an Amazon exclusive. It's insane.
It gets to the point where it's nuts. It really does.
Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon, getting reissued again, but this time on a mastered at 2LP at 45 single-sided disc with ultraviolet artwork. I couldn't think of artwork.
Thing
on the backside of the disc, so it doesn't affect the fidelity like a standard picture disc. The music's only pressed on one side, the artwork's on the other. I'm actually looking really forward to hearing that because I think it could sound great. So
mastered at 45 or cut at 45. I think, if it's, do we know, is it the Bernie Grumman?
I believe so. Okay. I get it tomorrow. So I'm going to open it up and check the mastering on it. But
tune in tomorrow. We're going to do another show.
And then most importantly, Mike, I know you're really excited about this. I'm going to put this with your Record Store Day stuff. A new, brand new Best of Bruce Springsteen.
Burn my box.
Being released this Friday.
Burn the box. Just burn it. Burn it.
Bruce only got two variants.
Yeah, shit and shittier.
Nope.
Old and older.
I'm seeing Springsteen on Sunday.
But will he see you? Because I'm sure he doesn't have good vision at his age.
Oh, he's going to see me, all right.
Whoa, there's Nick. Oh, no. Security. I need you now.
And
he's got goldfish with him again.
Right. Springsteen put out a book. No, he didn't. He can't write. That's not true.
Dennis Smith, as always, comes to my rescue.
Dennis is going to the Bruce show also.
No, he's not.
But anyways, that's what's coming out this week outside.
AR-15. He's gonna, no, please don't. All right. I didn't mean that.
You shouldn't have said that.
I didn't mean that. I'm not trying to imply that I don't hate Bruce. You should not bring bodily harm to Bruce. All right.
No, because remember, Mike's from New York, which means they have to like Springsteen.
No, incorrect. You got it wrong again. That's Billy Joel.
Yeah, but Bruce is a big deal in New York, too.
He is, because there's so many people from Jersey that moved to New York and vice versa. And so many people from New York that moved to Jersey. But he's a Jersey guy. It's a Jersey thing. Billy Joel is the New York thing. And when they come together, there's a gigantic typhoon.
Yeah, and everybody starts yelling about who makes better fucking meatball subs.
Yeah, something like that's exactly what happens, Nick. And then Gene Simmons comes in from out of left field going, I should make more money than both of these guys. And then, so there's the token Gene. Ah, there he is.
Nick, can you tell me where you received that candle? Because I need to sue those people for use of my name, image, and likeness.
Yeah, Gene? It doesn't have any copyright or license information on it, so it probably is a bootleg.
It says The Demon, which is my actual persona.
My first instinct is to sue.
To strike. Well, yes. That is very true. Yes.
My first instinct is to sue.
All right. Anyway, what I want to do now is it's time for our newest segment, everybody, which we now have a small intro for. It's not really that big of an intro, but are you ready for it?
I am.
It's your new favorite. It is called...
No!
That's right. No. It's time.
Wow.
Do you like that?
Outstanding. Thank do we even need to do the segment? Because I, of course, don't have any news.
Yes, we have to do the segment. It absolutely has to happen. Hang on one second. I got to bring it up. I bookmarked it. Bookmark. All right, there we go. Yeah, this is a good one. Now, this, I will admit, this did not happen last week or in the past month or whatever. This happened at near the end of last year. But the headline alone is worth the price of admission. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Here it is. Man shocked to discover source of headache for 5 months is pair of chopsticks inside his skull.
What?
This is a true story. A pounding headache led to a shocking discovery for a man in Vietnam after the source of the pain was revealed to be a pair of chopsticks. After the man experienced severe headaches for 5 months, doctors at Cuba Friendship Hospital in Dong Hoi told the 35-year-old man he had a pair of chopsticks lodged inside his skull, according to the New York Post. Upon checking to the hospital, a CT scan revealed the man was suffering from a rare, potentially life-threatening neurological condition that was caused by the pair of chopsticks that had allegedly gone up his nose and into his brain.
What?
The Post reported, while the man was initially surprised at how chopsticks ended inside his skull, he soon remembered a fight he was involved in while out drinking 5 months prior. The patient reportedly told doctors he could not recall many details from the fight, but did remember someone stabbing him in the face with an unknown object.
Wow.
I mean, well, I guess there's a happy ending to this story. The surgeons were able to successfully remove the chopsticks, and the patient was said to be in stable condition waiting to be released from the hospital. So good for that guy, but yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Maybe that's what the problem is with Paul McCartney.
I think somebody shoved more than just chopsticks up there. There's bigger issues going on there. Oh my God. Jeez. Yeah. Dumb news. That's
play,
so
play the intro again.
You mean this one?
No.
Did you mix that in Atmos?
No, but it does sound spatial, doesn't it?
Yeah, I felt it move through the headphones.
That was just delay and reverb.
Just panning?
It was two different types of reverb and delay, and then I pitch shifted my voice.
Fantastic.
The things we do for this stupid show.
That was outstanding.
Dumb news! Yeah. Do you have a dumb news article?
I don't. I forgot because we've been doing this show for 2 years. This is like the 2 year anniversary, because if you remember, the first one we did was RSD in 22.
Oh yeah, that's true.
So
happy 2 year anniversary.
We've done that segment exactly one time.
Yeah. And you forgot.
I forgot.
Well, next time.
Next time I'll have two to make up for it.
That's good. All right. So now that brings us to the piece de resistance for today. We are going to talk about things that we call... No. We're gonna...
What's happening, baby?
Hey!
Fuck you!
All right. So...
What's up?
All right. Anyway, we're going to talk about Record Store Day 2024, which again is this Saturday, April 20th, 2024. Again,
420...
And just, you know, for those stoners in the room. And so, Nick, you have things you like. I have things that I like. I mean, initially, we started talking about this about a month or so ago mm-hmm. on another show. I think two months ago. And you said, hey, save it. We're going to do a whole show on this. But I think the initial reaction was, as far as the list goes, it was meh. You know? It wasn't like, it didn't blow you away with like, Excuse me.
Jesus Christ.
It's been festering there for a while.
Can you get through a sentence without coughing or burping or something?
I'm sorry. I needed to do something. It was there and I had to do it. I'm sorry. But, you know, going through the list, it's like, you know, there's some things that are kind of cool. Like, nothing that beats you over the head is, holy crap, I need to get this. I have to admit, things have been added since, it looks like. In fact, some things look like they were added in the past, like, day, because there were things on the list that I missed. You know, things that I didn't put on my list. That now I sent my list to Nick so we can pull the titles that we can talk about, but one of them I missed completely was Tesla. Like, I didn't know that they had an album coming out, which I'm really looking forward to. Did you get those in the store?
Yeah, but that's one of those titles that was heavily, heavily allocated.
Yeah, it was like 2,500 pieces. So actually, since we're on that topic, let's go through the different release types, and then we could talk about these again. We do this every time. We give you the definitions as to which ones these are. There are three different types, essentially, of releases on Record Store Day. You have an RSD exclusive, an RSD first, and then something called the limited run or regional focus, RSD limited run. So, Nick, what is an RSD exclusive?
So a RSD exclusive means Record Store Day exclusive, and what that means is it's only going to be available on Record Store Day, meaning the pressing that is done for Record Store Day or in collaboration with it is the only pressing that they're doing of this. So, Mike, can you give me an example of a title? One of these?
One of the ones I gave you?
Yes, just so. Oh, here, I'll use the David Bowie one here as the example. Yeah. Okay, so this says Record Store Day exclusive, and this is limited to, I think it's like 6,000 or 7,000 copies. 8,000. Okay, 8,000 copies of this. So for everywhere, that's for the whole world, 8,000 copies of this, and it will only be released this one time. That's what Record Store Day exclusive means. It doesn't mean that there'll be a different version. It means the title is specific to Record Store Day. Yep.
And when you think about it, 8,000 copies of somebody as popular as David Bowie, that's going to disappear like that.
We're up to, just so everybody knows, I think it's in the United States, there's 600 stores participating.
Yep. And you figure if each one of them has five, and this is a worldwide thing.
Yes.
So you got to think, like, you know, 4,000 or 5,000 went worldwide, 4,000 or 5,000 are in the US, right? So
yep.
They're all, you know, they'll all disappear. Yes. So then what is an RSD first?
So an RSD first is, there's a version coming out for Record Store Day, but it will be released again. It will be different in the sense of that the Record Store Day might be version may be red vinyl, and then the one that comes out in a few months is black vinyl. So that would be the difference. Or maybe it's a picture disc and coming down the pike later will be a red vinyl or whatever. But like, RSD first means this title is coming out for the first time on Record Store Day, but there will be another version of it at some point. They never tell you when. It could be six months, it could be 2 years, but they're telling you that there will be another time that they release this particular
title.
Sometimes
it's happened where it's been the next week.
Yeah. I mean, look at what I was just saying about Pearl Jam. Like, they're putting out the record the day before.
The day before.
And there's a Record Store Day version the day after. So
I need to buy it, and then I need to buy it.
Yes.
Are you sure that Kiss is not managing Pearl Jam?
You would think, but I'm shocked that Kiss doesn't participate in Record Store Day.
No, Nick, we don't participate in Record Store Day because every day for Kiss is Record Store Day. Go to kiss.com, kissonline.com. Kiss condoms, Kiss casket, Kiss records, Kiss box sets, Kiss lotion.
Kiss lotion. Fantastic.
And then the third one is a limited run. Now, this one's really interesting. Go a little deeper on this one.
Okay, so the limited releases / regional run is usually, it can go a couple of different ways. It can go for, it's focused on the Midwest because this band or artist, their fan base is in the Midwest. Maybe they're a D or C level band that has reach, but they don't have national reach. So they put a focus on in the Midwest. We're going to put 1,000 copies in the stores throughout the Midwest. Now, if Mike wants that in California, chances are the stores aren't going to get it because it's focused in that region. On the other side of that is, it's so limited and it's so spread out. It could be an artist even like Paul McCartney. A few years ago, Paul McCartney released something that was a limited run, regional focus release, and it only went to like the top 25 stores. They all got one. I think it actually was signed by McCartney. That was the deal with it.
I got 24 of them.
Yeah, I'm sure. So it can run the gamut from those two extremes. But usually what it means is there's less than 1,000 of them available and it's in a focused market. Usually.
Some, I mean, I've seen some in 1,500, 1,000, 2,000, but it depends on the band too. And you know, but mostly it's 1,000 and under is what you usually see. So with that said, there's been some interesting controversy with this year's Record Store Day. Tell us about the Eric Carr albums that have disappeared off the face of the planet.
Okay, so we do know what happened to them now.
Okay, now we know. All right, so just to set the scene, Nick told me the other day, Eric Carr's albums are, nobody can find them. They're nowhere. Now, first of all, Eric Carr has put out so many more albums since he's been dead over the past 3 years. And he died in like 91, 30 years 92. Ago. Yeah. So, I mean, this guy, he's really prolific in his output.
He's like Tupac.
Really? I mean, Tupac put out what was it, 6 albums when he was alive and like 13 since or something? Yeah,
it's like Hendrix and Frank Zappa.
Yeah, exactly. So, well, Zappa put out a crap ton of albums when he was alive.
So yeah. Zappa put out 94 records when he was alive. So we
got some time to catch up to that one. But with that said,
Hendrix had Eric 3, Carr? Though. Okay, yeah, so yeah. the deal is with Eric Carr, because I see some stores have now ended up with them. I don't think we're going to get ours, actually. Well, I should say we're not going to get it in time for Saturday. So what the deal is, for those that are up on this title, this is a deluxe package. It has a book in it, 2 records, and an OBI strip. But the big thing about it is the cover is a replica of the Fox makeup when Eric was in the band for Creatures of the Night. So basically it's a take on the Creatures of the Night cover with just Eric on it. But the big thing is that the eyes glow, and not like how the Kiss album cover did. These have literal bulbs in them that light up like LEDs. On the cover. Yes. On the cover. So
all right, worth getting then.
It's super cool, and it's a really cool release, especially if you're a Kiss fan, obviously. But like, I love the concept of it. That's actually something unique that you don't see on almost any record. The only one I can think of is Pink Floyd Pulse that had the CD. Remember?
Yeah, with the red LED. Now this one was limited to 5,000.
Yes.
So, I mean, if Gene Simmons had anything to do with this,
he didn't have anything to do with this, as you might imagine. But the thing is these were pressed and assembled overseas, which a lot of records are. A lot of records are pressed at GZ Republic, Media. Yeah. Yes, which is GZ. And they get sent over here. Like, even when our store did the Alice Cooper in-store, almost all of the product came from overseas.
Yep.
So, because it came right from the pressing plant. So that's normal. That's not the problem. What the problem is that apparently Customs wasn't aware or wasn't informed that about these lights in the eyes, and it's a hazmat issue because the product hasn't been properly vetted and cleared, which we know a lot about from the music industry and shipping things with batteries and all kinds of stuff. So there's certain protocols with that. Well, what it sounds like, I'm not saying nobody did it, but somewhere along the line there's been a miscommunication, and Customs is holding a large amount of this particular product. So some have slipped out there, some have gotten through, but I have friends that own, you know, multiple stores and everything. And I think I have one person that I know that's gotten their copies of this record. So
great. So get my copy from him.
Yes. Yeah. Well, good luck. Good luck finding it. But the thing is, we will eventually get them. Everyone will eventually get them. I just don't think we're going to get them on Saturday. I think that's just where we're at with it at this point.
All good. Well, there you have it. And it wouldn't be a Record Store Day with some sort of weird controversy.
Oh,
right?
My God. Oh, and that's like the low that's the low totem pole one.
All right. Well, let's go through it. Let's show some things that are coming out this week. Now, start pulling them. We're doing this in alphabetical order, not in any order that we prefer it or don't prefer it or what have you. We're just going in alphabetical order. We're going to have to do this kind of rapid fire because we're already 50 minutes into this show.
Yes.
All right. This okay. one I love.
Yes, this is the first one I wanted to pull. This is the Airplane soundtrack. I'm sorry for the ring light, everybody, but that's the only way we can do this. The Airplane soundtrack, one of the greatest movies of all time, without a doubt. This is limited to 1,100 copies, and it's an exclusive Record Store Day release. Now, here's the big thing. There's 1,500 copies of this worldwide. 750 will be offered in the There Is No Stopping in the White Zone colored vinyl. And the other 750 is There Is No Stopping in the Red Zone colored vinyl. So I'm not sure what this is. I think it's a surprise when you open it. Oh, I'm sorry. This says...
It says on the label, right?
Yeah, There Is No Stopping in the Red Zone colored vinyl.
Now, in the white, maybe the White Zone has a white label?
I grabbed this out of our shipment, so I'm not sure how... Okay. I don't know.
Now,
very
mind
possible.
You, it's not like there's words on it, right? It's just like the orchestral score.
It's the score.
Elmer Bernstein. So,
yes.
So,
well, I don't know. It's got quotes from the movie, so I think it probably has some dialogue.
Something interspersed in there?
Yes.
All right, that would be cool, too. Well, cool.
I'm excited about that.
Yes. Next.
Okay, this was on your list, and it's also on mine. The Black Crowes' Waiting and Wanting, 7-inch.
Yeah, that had to be on there. I mean, they have a whole new album coming out, but this is the single.
Not coming out, it's out.
Well, there you go. So I didn't buy it yet.
Don't tell Chris Robinson.
I won't tell Chris. Well, I've already told the story about my interactions with Chris on this show before.
Yes.
Which is always funny. Like, you came around, right? Yes, Chris, I did. Chris, if you're watching, I know you are.
Yes, he's definitely watching. He's a big fan of mine, too. So,
yeah, he is. They have a 7-inch Wanting and Waiting. That is. And then there's a previously unreleased song from the recording sessions entitled Morsels for Mongrels on
yes.
the B-side.
Yes. And if you've seen the album is called Happiness Bastards. If you've seen it, the cover looks a lot like this. So they're mimicking that. And on the front, it says Wanting and Waiting. And on the back is the B-side track. What is it again? Morsels for Mongrels.
Morsels for Mongrels. Yeah. And this is limited to a total of 2,000 pieces. So really limited for
low for a band that is known for its rabid collector fans.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a good one. Next.
This was another one off your list, Mike. The Blur, Park Life.
You know, I love Blur. I think they're great. You know, and Damon Albarn is just anything he does just turns out to be really, really good. But I mean, who could forget song number two, right?
Yes.
That's not on this album. But it's, if you want to go more deep dive with Blur, check it out. I mean, I can't even name a song off the album, but I have heard it and it's good stuff. It's good, you know, great Blur music.
And he's the guy that's like, behind the Gorillaz too, right?
He is.
Yeah.
In fact, I saw a video recently that just made me laugh my ever loving butt off. The song Clint Eastwood, and that's the song that everybody knows by the Gorillaz.
Doom, dun, dun, doom.
When I'm happy, when I'm here, on sunshine in a bag. That beat, he actually took from, it was a Suzuki, like a keyboard, like a Casio style keyboard, but it's like round. And it's rock number one beat. And so that's all it is. And then the fill, the is like when you hit the solo button on that beat. So it's like this archaic, you know, keyboard thing. And he just took that and was like, all right, I wrote a song with it. It was a whole video on it.
And reinvented his entire career.
Exactly. So, but hey, look, why have one band when you can have two?
Yes. Well, especially because Blur wasn't a band at the time
it was pretty much just him.
So this is another one that's limited to 2,000 and it's an exclusive release. This is another one of, and I always say this wrong, Mike, I'm sure you know how to say it. Is it Zoetrope?
Zoetrope.
Zoetrope. I don't
know. Zoetrope.
That's the hot new thing this year because there's like 50 fucking releases with it.
Of these, and I wanted to bring that up. There are so many picture discs coming out. Yep.
But I'm not sure what the artwork is on this. We can show, we're going to talk about a couple others that are coming up that you'll be able to see the artwork on it. But I'm going to assume it's probably dogs running would be my guess based on the album cover. If you're not familiar with what those picture discs do, basically when it's on your turntable, if the is it it's like with the lighting or something, with the lighting's correct, it looks like the image is moving on the record.
Yeah, it's kind of creepy.
It's really creepy, actually. First band I ever saw do it was the Claypool Lennon Delirium, which is Les Claypool and Sean Lennon. They did it a few years ago, and it was I thought it was super cool. And then no one else did it, and then now all of a sudden it's like the thing.
Yeah, it's like the wavy kind of like, you know, like there's got to be layer. I'm sure it doesn't sound as good, but I'm sure it looks awesome.
Yeah.
You know, so you buy that for the collectability, not for the, you know, fidelity.
I will say that picture discs are better than they used to be. They are,
but I mean, it's still not the same, you know?
No.
I mean, there's obviously, you know, sometimes they're too thick, you know, which means that they'll never break, which is nice. But anyway,
it really depends on what you're in it for, because if you like the novelty side of it and the collectability side, they're cool releases. If you're in it for the fidelity, these aren't your releases. It's that simple.
But if you want to light up a spliff and stare at a spinning circle for 30 minutes and flip it over in another 30 minutes, this is what you want.
Yeah, right.
Next.
Okay, the next one I was showing a moment ago. This is David Bowie. Waiting in the Sky. And what's cool about this? Well, first of all, it's limited to 8,000 copies. Like we said, it's a record store day exclusive. But for those that are fans of the classic era of David Bowie, it doesn't get much better than this. This album is taken from the Trident Studios quarter inch stereo tapes from December of 1971. Which were created for the first track listing, basically, of what would become the rise and fall of Ziggy Stardust. And it includes four songs that never ended up on the Ziggy Stardust album proper. This is something I'm really excited to hear. It does have a ton of the classic Ziggy tracks on it, like 5 Years, Soul Love, Moon Age Daydream, of course, the title track, Hang On to Yourself. But there's a handful of stuff here that you haven't heard before. So and it's coming straight from the master tapes. So I think this is going to sound great.
Nice.
And I'm going to assume it's on, it says it's half speed mastered. I'm going to assume it's on white vinyl would be my guess.
It doesn't say,
but the Bowie, it wouldn't be Record Store Day without David Bowie. The last couple Record Store Days, though, that he didn't have one, so it didn't feel like Record Store Day to me.
Yeah, like the last one he had was like a 10-inch single or something like that.
The Toy EP.
Years ago. Yeah.
Yeah.
But he's back.
He is.
Again, somebody who's almost as prolific in death as he is.
Yes, that's true. You had this on your list do you want me to keep talking about these or you want to talk about this
what
one?
What is it?
The Dazed and Confused.
All right, so how could you not want the Dazed and Confused soundtrack? You know, I mean, first of all, the movie's hysterical. We all know that, right? Let me bring up the track listing for that because I think it was pretty.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's so, great song right after great song.
Where the hell? Where's the various artists section?
I can read it if you want. Free Ride, Edgar Winter Group, No More Mr. Nice Guy, Alice Cooper, Never Been Any Reason, Head East, Why Can't We Be Friends, War, Summer Breeze, Seals and Crofts, Right Place, Wrong Time, Dr. John, Lord Have Mercy on My Soul, Black Oak, Arkansas, I Just Want to Make Love to You, Foghat, Show Me the Way, Peter Frampton, Do You Feel Like We Do, Peter Frampton, and unfortunately, Living in the USA, Steve Miller Band.
Well, that right there is the reason to buy it, because you'll just annoy the living crap out of Nick.
Yep. And it's on 140 gram smoky purple vinyl.
Well, that's cool. Now, are they just cheaping out by going with 140 gram? Is that what it is?
That's standard size, ladies and gentlemen. It's 140 gram.
Like, yes. They call it out.
You know what? Because that, I mean, this is a whole nother debate. We're not going to have it right now. But a lot of people think the thicker records is a waste of vinyl.
Yep, because, you know, that they're, well, all right, really quickly, the theory is the thicker the vinyl, the more stable it is. Therefore, your needle is not vibrating too much. It's just in the groove, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas people feel like, well, you're really just wasting vinyl on this. You get the same amount of fidelity out of 140 gram, the same amount of stability out of 140 gram. Yeah. I don't have, you know, like...
I'm sure it depends on your system. It really does. It's
yeah. What it depends on is your ears.
Yeah.
You know, because if you've been listening to concerts for 40 years, guess what? It doesn't matter what you're playing at all. You've lost, you know, 2.8 and 4K. You're screwed. Sorry. Next. Yeah.
Another Zoetrope picture disc, but this is the one everybody's really excited about. The Dio Last in Line.
Yeah.
Hopefully Pat Middlestat's watching because I know he's been asking about this one.
Yep. So let's see that one. Come on. Where the hell did it go?
Hang on. I've got it. I know. I jumped ahead. Hang on.
I jumped ahead too. That was bad.
Okay. So this is limited to 4,500 copies. And it is a Record Store Day exclusive. Now, on this, what you're going to have is Murray, as Dio referred to the devil character, Murray. Murray is going to move around and rock his hand back and forth while you listen to Last in Line.
It's, you know what it is? You know what all these are? This is basically like the more modern version of those like stereographs. That, you know, it looks like just print nothing, but then like if you cross your eyes slightly, you see Snoopy as the Red Baron. You know,
it's sort of like that. It's a little easier. Like it's a little easier.
You don't have to go like searching for it. It's definitely there, and it's much cooler because you can listen to it as you do it.
Yes, and I know this has been reissued a handful of times, but you can't go wrong. This record and Holy Diver are absolute essential metal masterpieces. Yeah. They're must owns. So if you don't have a copy of Last in Line, or even if you do, you should probably have this.
We rock. Yes.
That's a great that really is a cool release. And I love that that Dio is celebrated every year. He's another Record Store Day staple. And
he's also a picture disc every year.
He's also a picture disc every year. Yeah, Wendy Dio, I think, goes out of her way to make him picture disc. But, hey, whatever. People like him. That's all.
And speaking of, there is the picture disc. Did you pull that one too?
I didn't pull that one because it's in our shipment that's coming tomorrow. So unfortunately, I can't show that. There is another Dio picture disc, again, Last in Line, but I think it's specific to a live Last in Line, right?
It's called The Last in Live.
Yes.
And it's just three tracks. It's Last in Line and We Rock Live, and on the B-side is Egypt, The Chains Are On, and Children of the Sea.
Which, Egypt, The Chains Are On is one of the best songs in the Dio canon.
So there you go. So you get them all on one tidy 12-inch picture disc.
Now, one thing to note about that one, I don't know if you saw, but it's limited to only 1,800 copies.
Yeah, it's very, very small pressing of that one.
Yes.
And then the other one was, how many was on?
4,500.
4,500, that's right.
Which is still very low.
You know, I'm just trying to navigate through this thing, and it's really being a dick.
There's probably a lot of people on it.
No, it's just the way that they set it up. Anyway, I got it.
Oh, another one of our customers, George, is watching. George has watched. He watched. He didn't watch it live, but when we did the Pink Floyd Dark Side of the Moon 50th set, he really enjoyed that video. But he just sent me a text and said, I love the Steve Miller comment. Yeah.
Wait, does he like Steve Miller?
No, he hates Steve Miller. Right, like any sane individual would.
Next up.
This one's for, actually, I'll send a shout out to George because this is one he's going to be very excited about. And again, it wouldn't be Record Store Day without a release from The Doors.
Always.
Every
year. Another year, another Doors album.
Another Doors album. But you know what I have to say? These are always, the pressing quality is always great. The sound quality is always great. It's almost always a live show. And if you like The Doors, which I know Mike doesn't because he's ridiculous, but they always sound great. This comes from the original multi-tracks of this show, and it's mixed by, of course, Bruce Botnick, who did all of their albums. So this is, you know, traditional. It's like an official release from The Doors. And this is a 3-LP set on translucent light blue vinyl. It's got both the early show and late show, and this is limited to 6,000 copies. And it is Wait, hang on. I just caught Record Store Day in some bullshit lies, like I usually do every time we do this episode. First off, let me just show that it is a stamp jacket, which is cool. But the website does say it's limited to 6,000, and this one here is number 1826 out of 11,500. So well, I'm not.
It could be 8,000 domestic and 3,500 for the rest of the world, but.
It is one of those things, because obviously these marquee artists, as we like to call them, your David Bowie's, your Doors, things like that. These are worldwide releases, so it very well could be 6,000 in the U.S. and then 5,500 in Europe.
It could have been the intention was 11,500 to begin with, and then that's happened before too.
Like, and then Taylor Swift jammed up all the pressing plants, and they couldn't make anymore.
Yeah. Also, what I found interesting is that they're releasing it on a CD as well, and that happens a lot with these legacy bands.
Yes,
but they actually are pressing more on CD, 8,000, like.
But I will say that's because a lot of times the Doors, at least I can say from our perspective, the Doors are one of the first artists we always sell out of. Like, whether we get 10 copies of it, 50 copies of it, whatever, it's like we're always selling out of it. And they are a band that it's not just the vinyl people, like, their fans will be happy with the CD. They want the show. So they are one of the bands that are getting a vinyl and a CD of the same release.
All right, what's next?
Next is, hang on, I'm pulling up my information. Faces, one of the greatest, most underrated bands of all time, the Faces, of course, featuring Rod Stewart and Ronnie Wood. Just great down and dirty rock and roll. This is called the BBC Session Recordings, not to be confused with the one that came out on Black Friday, which was also a BBC release. This is a much more in-depth compilation. It's a 2 LP set, and the stuff from the Black Friday release is not duplicated on here, and hopefully, I'll say for myself, hopefully it sounds better, because the one from Black Friday sounded absolutely terrible. I was so pissed that I bought it, because it sounded like shit.
Nothing more disappointing than spending hard-earned money on an album that you're looking forward to getting it home, putting it on your, you know, sometimes very elaborate system, just to have it sound like a wet fart. You know, I mean, like, I was like that with talk about something more recent, like Alice in Chains, Jar of Flies EP just came out. It sounds fantastic.
Yeah.
But when they released Dirt, it sounded awful. And on vinyl.
There is no reason that a record as great as Dirt should sound like crap.
It just sounds like somebody put like a dishcloth over the speakers. I don't know what it is. I don't know who mastered it. Whoever did really did not do a good job. Jar of Flies sounds miraculous.
They probably listened, you know, because I know there was a lot of people upset when Dirt came out, especially because people have waited forever for that to get reissued and for it to not be treated right. The one thing, I just going back to that Faces release, the thing that was most disappointing about it for myself was that it was issued by Rhino. I'm like, how could Rhino put this out and have it sound this bad? And it's probably a mixture of source material and things. The BBC didn't always keep the greatest. You'd think they had amazing archives, and they did for people like the Beatles and the Stones and things like that.
It could have been the source material, but
I'm hoping this one sounds better, because I'll be getting it, and I'm a huge fan of the Faces and just one of rock and roll's greatest bands.
So, speaking of Faces, hide your face with the next album.
No. Oh, here we got another Zoetrope picture disc.
Yep. There we go.
With George Harrison. This is electronic sound. They're doing both this and Wonderwall music, both Zoetrope. And if you're not familiar, they're basically synth records from George Harrison, where he's just experimenting with noises and things like that. It's definitely not for everybody.
Well, each side has exactly one song. So if that tells you.
Yes. And these were released when he was still in the Beatles too. So this is like 60. I know Wonder. I did say that right. Right. It's Wonderwall music.
I think you're right. Yeah. Cause this one's electronic sound.
Yes.
Right? And the other one, yeah, Wonderwall music. Yep.
Okay. Wonderwall music, I know for sure, is like 68. I can't remember what year this is. Maybe it says on the info here. Hang on.
Yeah, Wonderwall was 68. Electronic sound was
69.
Yeah.
Okay. And these, again, for being, you know, it's still George Harrison. There's only 3,400 of these. So,
well, they're going to go sell, quick. And I think 3,400 people are probably going to be a little disappointed.
3,300, probably.
Yeah. I mean, you know, even I bought Wedding Album by John and Yoko.
See, I don't even have that.
Yeah.
And I'm the Beatle guy,
Yoko!
Of the two of us. Jeez. I like to think.
Well, I found it. You know how much I paid for it?
$1.
$10.
There you go.
$10. I think it was $10 or maybe $20. Whatever it was really cheap considering the condition it was in. It had everything and the posters and everything else that goes along with it. And then I listened to it once and I'm never listening to it.
Yeah,
again.
It sucks.
Yeah, it's awful. Next.
This is a fantastic jazz release. Most people are going to go buy this if you don't know the history of it. And some of the greatest musicians ever are on this. Charlie Parker, Buddy Rich, Hank Jones, Lester Young, some of the most iconic jazz people are on this record. And I have a copy that I promise does not sound as good as this one will, because this is being done by Verve, and the LP has been mastered from the original analog sources. It is pressed on yellow vinyl, but I guarantee it's going to sound better than mine. But it is a fantastic jazz record. If you're a jazz person at all, you need to have this record. And it's very limited. How many? 3,500 copies.
Yeah, very, very few. Which a lot of those jazz releases usually are.
Yes.
A little more limited. I mean, for obvious reasons, it doesn't have the same kind of reach that some other types of music do.
Yeah. I mean, and that's just, I mean, the Doors are going to sell more records than Charlie Parker is at this point in time. So, and even somebody more modern than the Doors.
Do you have, this was one that I missed, and I think I actually asked you to put one aside for me, but do you have the GBI?
We just got it as I was leaving with this stuff. So we can talk about it, but I don't have it to show.
Yeah, GBI. So that stands for Grohl, Benante, and Ian. Dave Grohl, Charlie Benante, and Scott Ian. And they were what was happening was Anthrax was recording at Studio 606, which is Dave Grohl's studio. And Dave popped in and was like, hey, I'm going to hang out because it's a studio and it's whatever he wants to do. And then like he called the guys like, hey, you guys rehearsing today or doing anything today? You want to record some Bad Brains or, you know, anything like that? And they're like, sure. So they recorded a 7-inch, which has The Regulator by Bad Brains on it. And I forget what's on the other side. What's on the other side of that? So it's a Regulator. Yeah. On side A, and side B is Etched. Actually, there is nothing else on there.
So they just did the one Bad Brains cover.
They just
did
the one song. They said, I'm looking at it. We rip Regulator live in two takes the way it should be.
So I wonder, I know Frank Bello was there. I wonder if he plays bass on it.
He doesn't. I think actually Charlie plays bass. Scott plays guitar. Grohl plays drums.
Oh, okay, got it.
So return to Grohl on the drums, which is always good because that guy hits second to only John Bonham, I think, as far as like power.
Yeah. So, yeah, there was a video going around of them hanging out, and it was funny to watch Dave Grohl play on Charlie's kit because it's so many more drums and cymbals than you would ever see Dave Grohl use. But
and double bass and
which of course he you know, I'm sure it's gonna be great. I can't wait to hear that.
Yeah, that'll be a good one. Next.
This is another that now this is a RSD first release, like we were just talking about. So this will be issued again.
Really quick, RSD exclusive on the GBI, limited to 3,000 pieces.
Yes, it was. We got allocated heavily on that. I think we ordered we ordered 25 and I think we got 13. So,
wow.
Yeah. So this one I pulled because I think this is this sounds like it's really cool. I haven't heard it yet, but this is called Right Now by Little Richard. And what it is it's a live show recorded in one night. It says, there's a cover of Sitting on the Dock of the Bay on here, plus some classic Little Richard, and this is on Sunflare vinyl. So what I'm going to guess is that's probably orange vinyl with some red swirl in it.
Yeah, it's probably like a burst.
Okay.
Or, yeah. Well, no, wait. If it's a flare, it's probably got like those kind of looks to it.
Yeah, that's like what I was thinking.
White,
like
interspersed with the with
orange with some red and some white in there. I think it'll be a similar to a swirl vinyl. Yeah. But this is only 1,200 copies, and it says the audio is restored and mastered by Grammy-winning engineer Michael Graves. So I think this is going to sound good. This is a one that stuck out to me when I was going through the list. I thought this would be kind of cool to hear.
Nice. Next.
Next one is Motorhead.
It wouldn't be Record Store Day without a Motorhead album.
And then this one's called Remorse. No.
No.
And why is it called that? See, Scotty and I had to talk about this yesterday because he ordered kind of light on this because he thought it was just a reissue of No Remorse. And in a sense, it is. But what's different is it replicates the No Remorse track list, but with alternate versions.
There you go. So like or, demos, lives.
Exactly. It's a mixture of stuff. Demos, lives, alternate takes, it's mostly demos. There is instrumental versions of a couple songs on here, but yeah, it's a cool mix of stuff, and it is classic live. So it's like there's a version of Stay Clean on here from Newcastle City Hall in March 81. So this is like classic fucking Motorhead, and No Remorse is one of the greatest compilations ever assembled. So I look forward to hearing this one too.
And that one's only 2,100 pieces.
That's really low for That's Motorhead. Low.
Yeah.
It's really low.
Hey, one thing that we passed, just to bring it up, John Lennon, Mind Games.
Being yes, I don't have on, that here.
Yeah, I didn't put it on the list. I passed it up by okay. accident. So, okay. But Mind Games is being released both in black and colored variants on Record Store Day, which is interesting.
And I'll tell you right now, the color is going to be hard to find. The color version is going to be hard to find because all the copies we got, I think, are black.
African-American. Let's see. What did they say for those? Where is it? John Lennon. Lennon. They don't have numbers.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think it's... I don't think there's a lot of the color Mind Games out there.
Huh. Now, mind you, this is just an EP. It's not the album.
No, it's the EP to help promote the box set that's coming down the way.
They're the ultimate mixes.
Yes. They've been doing one of those a year for the last few years. They did Imagine. They did Plastic Ono Band.
All right. Next.
Next thing, Mudhoney Box. You wanted to pull this.
Well, what about the Motley Crue? You didn't have that?
I don't have it yet.
Okay, so yeah, let's just talk about that really quick. Motley Crue, Supersonic and Demonic Relics, for those that are into the hair and lipstick crowd. Basically, it's there. I don't know what it is exactly. I don't know if it's a live thing. I don't know.
No, it's outtakes and it's all the B-side stuff. That came out on CD in the late 90s.
There you go. So it's first time on the LP kind of thing.
Yes, and
in
I can't
Motley Crue fashion. There is no description.
I can't remember if it's a picture disc or not. I think it might be.
It's not. It's a double LP. Oh no, okay. No! I take it back. It is a double LP picture disc, 2,500 RSD exclusive.
Yeah, that one's gonna go fast too.
Totally.
It's not gonna be around long.
All right, so Mudhoney. I mean, Mudhoney's great. You know, like the the whole Seattle scene. You know, Mudhoney was one of those that kind of like really kind of snuck under the radar. A lot, you know, Mark Arm, just really good dude. Mudhoney's just got a lot of great stuff. So I just wanted to throw out a shout out to them. You know, if you ever watch like Tommy Boy, like they're all over that soundtrack. You know, if you think you don't know Mudhoney, you know Mudhoney.
Yes.
So I mean, this is basically, I don't know if it's everything when they were on Reprise. I think it might be everything when they were signed to Reprise.
It's their three Reprise records plus an EP and two bonus LPs of live tracks, B-sides, and unreleased demos. So yeah, I would say it's probably the whole canon from their time on that label. I don't know a lot about this band, so I could be wrong, but it's looking like that it's if this isn't everything, I don't know what else they could have included, because there's a lot of shit on here.
It's a lot. I mean, it's a five LP box set, so
yes.
I mean, you got to have at least four songs on there that you like.
Oh, I know one thing that we skipped that I made a point to bring.
Oh, what's that?
Hang on 1 second, if I can get it out of this.
We're hanging on 1 second while Nick looks through the box.
So we've already been getting tons of calls for this, and I figured I'd just show them on here, because come Saturday, I'll never see these again. If I can get them out of this freaking bag.
Oh, come on.
Okay. The Beatles, three inch records from the Beatles.
I didn't put them on the list because I didn't think you were going to have them, because you need to have the player.
Yes, you have to have the player, which... every record store day, it seems like it's the people at Crosley. They select an artist and they do these mini turntables with 3-inch records. I think last year, if it wasn't last year, it was the previous year, they did the Doors. Previous to that,
this is not the first time they've done the Beatles, though.
I think it is. It's not. It's the first time they've done it. The 3-inch records. They did a turntable before. You're right.
Okay, they did a turntable, but not the records.
Correct.
Interesting.
I take that back. I don't think they did they didn't do the mini record player. They did a full size Crosley.
I thought they did.
I don't think so. But before they did Anthrax too, and they did a couple other bands.
I know they did the Doors, as you mentioned. I seriously thought there was a Beatles one too before that, but regardless, they're out now. So, I mean, I'm frequently wrong. So, and I'm sure the fidelity on these is outstanding.
Yeah, I'm sure it sounds just as good as the mono box set.
Yeah, I mean, like this or CD. I don't know which one is better.
So, this is in celebration, obviously, of the 64, 60 years ago already, of the Beatles coming to the USA, playing on the Ed Sullivan Show. So what you get in these 3-inch records are the songs that they performed on Ed Sullivan. Saw Her Standing There, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Till There Was You, and She Loves You. So I think the packaging is great, obviously, for a Beatle nut that I am. I think it's really cool. You can get the records separate, okay? Or if you buy the package, it comes with the Beatles turntable, a small carrying case, plus a set of the records.
What does that go for?
I believe like $129, I think. It could be less.
Start buying now for Christmas.
Yes. Like I said, I Scotty was like, dude, you don't need these. Because I was like, oh, I got to get a set of these. He's like, you don't need that. So,
well, from a fidelity standpoint, no, but from a collectability standpoint, yes.
I love the idea, and I love what it's celebrating. The box that the turntable comes in with the carrying case is cool. It's got some really cool artwork of the Beatles gear and stuff from the Ed Sullivan stage, and it's definitely something to celebrate, man. It's that's Let's something celebrate. Like that's never gonna have it happen.
I'm gonna
again,
have a party. All right, next.
Okay, next is, let's see, let me pull my screen up. Oh, Pearl Jam.
Ah, Dark Matter, variant number 8,000.
Variant number 8,168. I am not sure what...
This is a very, very, very limited number. It's only 15,000 pieces.
Only 50, but again,
it's Pearl Jam, so they will buy it, people will buy it. Because they didn't buy the black one on Friday, so they'll go back record store day and get this one.
Yeah, different colored vinyl. This looks to be some sort of like green gold burst.
They call it yellow and black ghostly dark matter LP colorway. That's what it says. Literally, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame inductees, yes. Pearl Jam return with an exclusive yellow and black ghostly dark matter LP colorway. For record store day 2024. Okay.
Well, there's that. There'll also be 700 other variants available. I'm sure it's good, though. I see here that Andrew Watt produced it, who's really becoming the guy to get. If you're a rock band, you want him doing your record. I met him a few times when he was playing in a band with Glenn Hughes called California Breed, and great guitar player, great producer. So it's cool to see him making the rounds like this. Like now he's producing a Pearl Jam record.
There you go. By the way, just open your Crayola box and pick a color, and that's going to be a variant. Next.
Okay. You keep saying next, but you're not giving me a chance to get to the information I need.
I have info. All you got to do is grab the record.
Okay, you do have info? Because a minute ago, you're like, I can't get this fucking thing to work. I couldn't get it to work.
You know, I know what's next.
What is it?
Oh, yeah.
You motherfucker, you. I'm going to sing on this album, you motherfucker.
Let me tell you, hot title here, and we got so shafted on this.
Really?
We ordered like 25 of these, and I think...
For those that are not watching this, it's Joe Pesci, Little Joe Sure Can Sing. That's why I was doing the impression.
So we ordered like 25 of these. I'm not kidding, Mike. We got four.
Well, you know how many were released?
1,400.
Yeah.
But I was kind of thinking this would be like my secret release here.
I think everybody probably thought that.
It's like the Macho Man one from last year.
Pow, ping, pow.
I got it. I'm getting one of these, though. This is happening. This is going
to... How many did you get?
Four.
How many are actually going to make it to the floor?
Three.
No. I asked for one.
Yeah, but I thought that was the one where you said you don't care if you got it or not.
Nah, I want it now.
See? What the hell? Can't do that.
It's probably $45.
They do... there's no price on this. It is. Oh, again, that number's wrong, dude, because this is hand numbered. This is copy number 1535 out of 2000.
It's 1535 out of 1400.
Yes. But there's no way that Joe Pesci singing Fixing a Hole can't be in my collection.
I said to this guy, Bing, I said, I need to do 2,000 copies. He said, no, it's 1,400. Ping. What are you doing over there? Pow, ping, pow. You motherfucker.
Hey, I'm fixing a hole where the rain gets in.
The fucking hole. I dig a hole in the desert and pow, ping, and put a guy in the rain gets in.
You know what I'm noticing, too? There's three Beatles songs on here, and then there's three Bee Gees songs on here.
Oh, my God. Well, Gotta Get You Into My Life is on there, right?
Yes.
Yeah. That was like the one thing that set me. I heard that like 30 years ago. And he's like, Gotta Get You Into My Life. Oh!
Yeah, this is a must own. Clear
Pow,
with
ping.
Clear with orange swirl vinyl.
Oh my God. It's even colored vinyl. Okay.
It is an RSD first release. So if you do miss out on it, you'll have another shot at it.
Oh, all right. Maybe I'll get sell it, make your money. Next. I'd rather buy a Steve Miller record, says Pat Middlestat. No, that's wrong, dude. Yeah, come on. Right.
Yeah,
now,
well,
this one I wanted you to bring up.
There goes Pat's chances of getting anything he wants.
Yeah, he's not going to get anything now. Now this is the Ramones. These are the demos for the first album, which leads me to believe, how could it sound worse than the first album?
Yeah, good point.
So that's why I was like, I'm not even that big of a Ramones fan, but there's a ton of Ramones fans out there, and it's great for them. And that's awesome that you're going to get these demos. But if the first
it's album what is, got them signed, this is what got them
if
signed.
The first album is that raw, how raw are the demos? And did they just take the demos and put it on wax in the 70s?
Yeah, right. Because, well, I can tell you one way they can make it sound worse. Black splattered clear vinyl.
Black splattered clear vinyl. Okay. All right.
No, I always get the Ramones releases. I love the Ramones. And the older I get, the more I love them. Like, because I see more... more of what they were going for, like the surf rock thing. And like, I know they're always the punk band, like they're the punk pioneers. Yeah. Right. But they've got that like surf and melodic 50s influence, which I think is really cool.
Yeah. Ever since I saw that on the list yesterday, California Sun has been playing through my head over and over and over. Great I know it's song. Not on that album, but I mean like their version of it is just like flowing through my head repeatedly.
6,000 copies of that, and that is an RSD exclusive, and they're another band that We sell out of their releases always.
Rabid fan base.
Rabid fan base. And another rabid fan base is the Rolling Stones.
There they are, the first album.
Which was released this week, 60 years ago.
And wasn't it, there was something about like, it was only released on vinyl in the UK or something like that, or?
No, this is something else. This is something else. This is the UK version of it.
That's
because
what it is, yeah.
The Stones were one of those bands that, similar to the Beatles, they had US versions of their records and UK versions of the records.
Yep.
So this is the UK version. So this is like how people would have heard it when it came back or when it came out in 1964. It's got their great version of Route 66 on it. I'm a King Bee. Most of this is covers. I think actually it might all be covers. I think the whole thing is covers. It comes with a lithograph on archival paper, blue and black swirled vinyl, and it is exclusively numbered. This is a low amount, Mike. This is number 1953 out of 13,000.
For the Rolling Stones, that's low.
That is low. To be fair, it is low. Yep. And again, the Record Store Day website says 6,000.
Because they don't know what they're doing.
No, but again, it's like the Stones, obviously, they're probably bigger in Europe than they are here. So it's like 7,000 of them are probably there. You know what I mean? It's like it's split. Maybe 6,500 copies in each spot. And there is another Stones release of them recorded live late last year when Hackney Diamonds came out, which if you haven't heard that record, you're missing out. I think it's a great to still
now,
get
that's
a new
an album that has a ton of variants.
Yes.
That album has at least 32 variants.
Because they did all the baseball teams,
every
right?
Every baseball team.
Plus there was a Target version, plus there was an Amazon version, plus there was a Walmart version, plus there was an indie store exclusive version.
We're talking 40 plus variants.
At least.
Probably done.
At least. They might win. But it's a live show that was recorded in the day that record came out, and Lady Gaga comes out and plays with them. They do some Stones classics as well as some of the songs from Hackney Diamonds.
Now that one's an RSD first, so that's 7,000. Let's see what's different about that one. 180 gram heavyweight solid white vinyl for Record Store Day. So that's what's different about that. When it comes out as a regular release, probably just be standard black vinyl.
I would
180
think.
180 gram. Yeah.
I'd rather buy a Steve Miller record than the Stones. That's even more ridiculous.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm not going to fight with Conchetta. So Connie's good people.
Well, I'm not saying she's bad people, but that's a ridiculous statement.
Oh my God, I can't believe her. Why did she say that? She's bad people.
I pulled this because I figured this is something you would be interested in.
Oh, did you?
This is the Corey Taylor release.
Yeah.
For RSD. I wonder where he got the idea for that cover.
Yeah.
Can anybody tell me?
Band on the Run. And then there's Corey Taylor.
This is basically Corey Taylor
covers, right?
It's all covers, but here's the thing. There's Stone Sour and Slipknot songs on this. So I don't think that's fair to call them covers. Those are his songs.
Redoing them, yeah, but I mean he's covering them.
Sure. But he does do Killing Machine by Judas Priest, Shot in the Dark by Ozzy, Killing Moon by Echo and the Bunnymen. And here was a surprising pick for somebody like Corey Taylor, I thought. 10 Years Gone by Led Zeppelin.
I'm curious.
Could be cool. I'm sure.
I mean, look, Corey Taylor has a great voice. I mean, yeah. Let's take Slipknot out of the equation. When he sings, the dude can sing.
Yes.
Like, he's got an incredible voice. He just can scream just as well as he could sing, so, or growl, whatever you want to call it. And he could seamlessly go between the two still, which is impressive in a lot of ways. So.
Skipknot. Now, this is a great release. And I hope everybody is getting this, because if you all go out and buy it, then we'll get more of them. Thin Lizzy, Live and Dangerous at Hammersmith, November 1976. Yeah. So this is not Live and Dangerous, the record. This is one of the shows that was recorded for Live and Dangerous.
Yep.
you guys have seen, it was probably about a year ago now, I talked about the Live and Dangerous box set that came out where you got all the shows in their entirety or pretty damn close to it. There was some tape damage on a couple shows, so they couldn't give you any, they couldn't give you all the shows in full, but the sound quality and the performances on all of those shows are ridiculous, ridiculous good. They sound great. And the thing that I love is that it silences the people that said, oh, that record's so overdubbed. They didn't play that great live. No, they did. This is a band firing on all cylinders. This is the classic lineup of Thin Lizzy, Brian Downey, Phil Lynott, Scott Gorham, and Brian Robertson. It doesn't get any better than this. And you must purchase.
It might get better than that.
It doesn't.
Oh, okay.
I'm telling you.
I love hyperbole.
Yeah, well, you know.
Before you grab the next one, I know I mentioned the Tesla album before, Reel to Reel.
Yes.
I do want to bring that one up again because it is a stupid limited number. It's an RSD exclusive of 1,500 pieces. It's something that was released previous, but this is the first time it's on vinyl. And the reason why I want to bring this up is because that, first of all, it's all cover tunes. Which, and you know every song on this album, you know, Space Truckin', so there you go, there's your Deep Purple.
Yes.
Walk Away, James Gang, Bad Reputation, Thank You, I've Got a Feeling.
Killer version of Ball of Confusion on there,
Ball of Confusion, Rock Bottom, Honky Tonk Women, Dear Mr. Fantasy, and a couple others, Bell Bottom Blues. There's a few more on there that I skipped over, but this was recorded on all analog equipment. And now it's been mastered and put on vinyl.
Yeah.
So I'm sure the mastering process was digital. But the fact is, this was recorded with all microphones, with all amplifiers onto tape, mastered down to tape, and then now mastered for vinyl. So I'm excited about it. I didn't even know about this thing existing till yesterday, to be honest. I don't know how I missed it before. And now I feel like I'm going to miss out on the album.
Yes.
Because there's only 1,500 pressings. So it's kind of kick-ass that they did that. And they're going to be touring for it, too. So if Tesla comes around, you're going to see a whole lot of covers being played, which is not a bad thing because Tesla does really good covers.
They did it. That record's like got to be 15 years old.
It was a while ago.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a great collection.
Next.
Okay. This one, I think this probably flew under a lot of people's radars because a lot of people weren't even aware that this was a band. Tinted Windows. Are you familiar, Mike?
I am not. So you're going to tell me about it.
Okay. So Tinted Windows was basically a super group. It has James Iha of the Smashing Pumpkins, Adam, I always say his name wrong, Adam Schlesinger of Fountains of Wayne, Bunny Carlos of Cheap Trick, and Taylor Hanson of Hanson. This is great rock power pop at its finest. Great stuff. If you've never heard this record, it's fantastic.
You know, now that I think about it, I did hear of that project before, and I always found it weird. Why is Bunny Carlos hanging out with somebody from Hanson? But you know, it seemed creepy.
I think they're just playing some good music together.
Yeah, they're playing something.
First time on vinyl for the album. It includes two bonus tracks, and it's pressed on red and black vinyl. This was another one that was heavily allocated. We ordered like 15 of them and got two.
It was only 1,800 released.
Yes.
So,
but I thought, again, this was another one that I'm like, nobody's going to be paying attention to that because most people don't know what it is. But now that you know what it is, even if you don't get a vinyl copy of it, you should listen to it streaming or whatever. It's a great, great record.
There you go. Next.
I'm starting to lose my voice, Mike. You gotta talk at some point here.
Well, I mean, I do talk here and there, but you know more about this stuff than I do.
I don't know more about this one.
I don't know anything about it, apart from the fact that it's U2, but it's Live from the Sphere. So that's why I wanted to put it on there, because that's the hip new venue in Las Vegas. If you don't know what the Sphere is, it literally is a sphere. And it is... it's an experience.
Yes.
Because the projections, first of all, everything envelops you. I think, I forget how many speakers are in there. It's like some ungodly number of speakers are in the arena.
Yeah, it's like the speakers 10,000 or something.
I think it's more than that. I think it's well more than that. I got to look it up. Let's see. Speakers in the sphere. Speakers in the sphere. Let's see. It's powered by Holoplot. Let's see. Go away. It's a 160,000 square foot concave, $2.3 billion thing. 17,500 seats. I know that's how I know it's well more than 10,000 because every seat has speakers in it.
How many seats is it? 17,000?
17,500, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's big, dude. And on the outside, there's you've seen it on like the Super Bowl and other things where there's like images that are broadcast on it. Of course, they sell, you know, airtime on it, if you will, for promotions. But it looks like one uniform screen, but when you get up close, there's all these hockey puck sized things about this big with a lot of space in between them. The thing is, when you're far away from it, you can't tell. It's amazing. So anyway, U2 basically debuted the Sphere.
Yes.
And they had a residency there and they kept extending it. And now I think this week Fish is there. And then soon the Dead will be there doing, are you going to that?
No, I couldn't afford it.
Because how much were tickets?
It was like the cheapest was like $250. But, you know, if you want to be actually a part of what's going on, it was about $400, $500 per person.
Well, that plus your room in Vegas, plus your gambling losses, plus your food.
Here was my favorite thing. I was trying to go. Rachel was going to go. And I was like, remember, Mike, you got in the ticket thing with me because we were trying to see who would end up in there first. Because Mike was like, well, if you don't get in, you know, maybe I can get what you need or whatever. And I said, well, if I get the VIP package or whatever, I'm like, I get transportation to and from the airport. And you go, dude, it's a 12-minute Uber.
Yeah, really. I mean, it's not like it's too far away, you know. I'm not saying you could walk there, but you could walk there.
Yeah.
You don't want to. It's very hot and there's too many homeless. But anyway, so on this, it's just an EP. It's just two songs. It's Atomic City live at the Sphere. And then there's a remix of Atomic City, which is one of the newer U2 singles. So, but anyway, if you care about the Sphere and U2 playing at the Sphere, and a lot of people do, it'd be a collectible for you. Let's see, how many of those were there? Those
3,000.
There you go. Only 3,000 for a U2 12-inch. That's
red vinyl with a poster included, limited edition.
That will be a collectible.
Yes.
Anything that comes with a poster or anything like that, buy it and don't open it. Just hold on to it.
Yeah, because this is an RSD first, which means it'll probably come out again and it'll be on black vinyl with no poster. Probably
no poster, exactly. Yeah. So, what's up next? I think I know what's up next.
You should know what's up next because it wouldn't be a Record Store Day for Mike Venezia if he didn't get a Voivod record.
Gotta have a Voivod album in there. Yes. Yes.
Only 900 copies of this.
I know. It's super small.
Limited run.
I don't know why.
It is an RSD first, so they're going to do it again. But
yeah, I mean, it's a new album. But, you know, still, it seems like very little for them. I'm wondering why. What is it? Yellow Blue Swirl double vinyl. Now, I have to say,
some of the song titles are outstanding.
Oh yeah.
The end of dormancy.
I conspiracy. Spherical perspective. Sonic mycelium. The only problem that I have. And by the way, in the description, it says 1,000 vinyl copies available worldwide. So who knows how many there actually are. The problem with Voivod stuff, I don't know why I've been snake bitten by it. So when Nothing Face came out a couple of years ago, I got two copies because yep. I love that album. Needed to have it. I only opened one and it was supposed to be purple and blue, purple and or pink and blue splatter vinyl. And it was like all pink with like a drip of blue. Like, that's not splatter. That's like an accident. It's like somebody knocked over the blue and a little bit got on this record. I wasn't going to open the other one to see if it was any better. I was like, ah, it is what it is. But anyway, just
that's the problem sometimes with the multicolored vinyl.
Yeah, because it's the point is that you get your own unique version. Sometimes it's a little too unique. Next.
This is one I pulled. I'm a big funk fan, and this is a great compilation if you're into funk. It's got Funkadelic, Detroit Emeralds, Fantastic Four, Ohio Players, Dennis Coffey. A lot of Detroit artists on this. A lot of these songs were recorded at United Sound in Detroit. This is a great comp from Westbound Records. Curated by Record Store Day. What else is there to say? I mean, it's if you like funk, you should have this.
We want the funk.
Hang on. There was one thing I wanted to point out about this, because it says something in the description about Detroit. And now I can't find it. It doesn't matter. Westbound Records rules. Almost anything on that label is great. That's where P-Funk got their start. And it's Detroit history.
There you go. Next.
We're getting down to them, folks. We only got a couple left. You pointed this out, that you were excited about this. The story of The Who.
I am stoked about this. I didn't even know that this thing existed.
I'd never heard of it either until I saw it on the list this year.
And it's actually a compilation that initially came out in 1976. And it's thought of as being basically the ultimate collection of The Who. Now, since it came out in 76, you're not going to see certain things on there. You're not going to see Who Are You. You're not going to see some other albums from that late 70s era on there. But you will see, you know, all the other stuff like Magic Bus, Substitute, Pictures of Lily, The Seeker, Happy Jack, Amazing Journey, like half of Tommy.
Yeah, I was going to say, side three is like a best of.
It's all Tommy.
It's like a truncated version of Tommy. Yeah.
It's like Tommy if you just want to like fast forward through the shit songs, you know, which there really aren't any on Tommy.
No,
it's such a great album. But I mean, it's the highlights, though they have Fiddle About on there, which I found weird.
Yeah, but it's an important part of the story, so maybe that's why.
It's just,
you know what I'm surprised to see is that for this, if this came out in 76 originally, there's nothing from Quadrophenia on here.
Yeah, I that was another thing, and in fact, but it does have stuff from The Who by Numbers.
Yes.
Like Quadrophenia was 74, right?
Quadrophenia 72, 73.
Okay. And Who by Numbers was 75?
Yes.
So you got Squeezebox on there.
And Slipkid.
But you don't have anything from Quadrophenia, which is weird.
That is super weird, because you would think at least Love Rain or Me or The Real Me would be on here, 515. But this is a fucking great comp, man, front to back. This is, if you didn't own anything else by The Who, this would be a great thing to own.
You know every single song on this compilation. If you've ever turned on the, you know, classic rock radio, you know every song on this. And it's pressed, there's an 8-page booklet reproduced for this, and it's on colored vinyl, pink and green colored vinyl. And it was mastered by John Astley, who's been with The Who forever.
Yeah, he's Pete Townsend's brother-in-law.
Yeah, so there you go. That's why he's with him so long. And it was cut at Abbey Road Studios. So you got some history going there.
And shot of the pinball machine getting blown up on the front.
Yep. There you go.
It's pretty sweet.
So, yeah, I mean, I thought that was pretty awesome. I didn't even know that that compilation ever existed. I think it was a UK-only release or something like that. Maybe that's what I was thinking of from before when there was, let's see.
Yeah, it's never been
never released in the U.S. Yeah.
Pink and green vinyl.
And 4,500, is that right? Did I have that right?
Yes, 4,500.
Yep. Okay, what else?
We have not one, but two releases from the Yardbirds.
Now, this confused me.
Okay.
A little bit.
Confuse you?
Now, I put them on there, like I chose them, because they're both released on different record labels.
Yes.
One is a live one. One is a B-side thing.
Yes.
I don't know which would be the more official.
Okay. Well, this one, the front one.
I'm assuming
here,
that one's the more official. I mean, the B-sides one is more official because that's taken from every portion of the Yardbirds history. It's got Clapton tracks. It's got Jeff Beck tracks. It's got Jimmy Page tracks.
Yes.
But the Five Live Yardbirds one is, I think, just with Clapton, right?
Yeah, it says it contains Eric Clapton's earliest recordings. Vinyl has been out of print and unavailable until now. Collector's edition, one pressing worldwide, deluxe package includes... Well, this, I think we just answered it, Mike. You ready? Which one of these is more official? Because it says this deluxe package includes printed inner sleeve.
Oh, well, that makes all the difference.
So this is definitely the less official. But Culture Factory does good reissues, so this probably sounds good. It was recorded live at the Marquee Club, and it does have Eric Clapton. So that's him right there in the center.
Yep. All clean shaven and pre-heroin use.
Pre-terrible.
You can't say terrible, man. I mean, the cream stuff is really, really good.
The cream stuff is great. Derek and the Dominoes is great. The Yardbird stuff is great. The Blues Breakers is great.
Yeah.
Then that's it.
Yeah, I'm not necessarily a fan of his solo work.
But all that 1970, stuff, like yeah. 64 to 70, Clapton is great. And then we've had 54 years of
You can only bad. Innovate so long, Nick. You can only innovate so long.
That's not true.
What else is left? Is that it?
No, I got one more because
which one you probably have, right?
I'm what do I have?
Take a guess. Neil Young and Crazy Horse?
Yeah.
All right, there we go.
Fucking up.
Yep. That's literally the name of the album, ladies and gentlemen. We're not cursing just to be cursing. It's literally called Fucking Up.
So here's what we were talking about earlier with Pearl Jam, with them putting out the record the day before and then having an RSD version. How about Neil Young putting one out on RSD and then it officially coming out the following Friday?
And there we go. So
there's Neil Young and Crazy Horse Fucking Up. And they say, they imply that this is different versions of the songs from Ragged Glory. But there's a track list on here, but everything is under a different title. So I'm not really sure what this is. Because it says Neil Young, Crazy Horse Fucking Up in all its Ragged Glory. Nine songs, two LPs, clear vinyl plus exclusive litho.
You know, these lithograph things, how many people ruin those the minute they take it out of the damn sleeve?
It's usually ruined when it was put in at the packing plant and they put it in wrong.
Shove it in there and it's already got a bent corner and you're like, all right, I'm done. Don't buy things because of a litho.
Well, let me tell you too, just based on my, you know, experience with Neil Young product, which always sounds great. It's always pressed fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
The jackets
are
always good.
He's an audiophile. I mean, he's
absolutely
like the guy.
But let me tell you, this lithograph is going to be that horse. I can guarantee it. I haven't opened this, but the lithograph is going to be a black piece of paper with a white silhouette horse.
All right, there you go. You heard it first, ladies and gentlemen. When we do our 50th episode, we'll see if Nick was right.
Maybe you know what? Am I keeping one of these? Because I was going to say we could open it on air right now. I made my list very small this week. We could. Or this year.
You could open it.
Yeah,
how
but
many
I don't,
did you get?
I don't know. See, I don't have Scotty here to tell me, no, don't do that.
All right, well, why is Scotty not watching and supervising you?
Because Scotty was at work at 6:30 in the morning this morning.
No, wham. let's see. How many were pressed? 5,000.
Yes. 5,000.
5,000 were pressed, so you may have a few.
I don't know for certain, so I don't want to take that liberty.
Listen, did I tell you about the man was shocked to discover that there were chopsticks in his skull?
Yes, you did.
God.
You know what? I'm going to open it.
All right, here we go.
Because,
we're going to see.
Because
we're
I'm see almost positive. Right. I'm
we're
almost
see.
Positive.
This is breaking news, ladies and gentlemen. Not fake news. This is breaking news. We're going to see exactly. And by the way, did you see the technique Nick used to open it? That's rub it on your leg technique.
Which, if you want to keep the shrink on.
Yeah, or you could just get a little blade and cut it very
well
gently.
I don't want to stand up right now. And
but listen.
It's a little tight in here, which is why I don't want to shoot in here.
It's tight in your pants too, I heard there, buddy. Yo! Hey,
you know what I mean?
Hey, yo.
All right.
I'm over here now.
Okay, is this where the litho is?
Let's see. Litho's going to be ruined in about 3, 2, 1.
Oh, that's the inner sleeve. Hang on.
That's the inner sleeve. That's not the litho. All right. Here we go.
All right, this has got to be
Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, is the litho a horse? He's already bent it.
No, there's so many goddamn things in this package. Here's the litho.
This is the weirdest unboxing ever.
Are you ready? You ready for the litho?
I'm ready for the litho. Hey! Yeah, baby, it's a horse!
I told you.
It is the horse, as, as Nick predicted. There you go.
I told you.
We have it right. Oh, that was such a great reveal. Okay. Congratulations, Nick. You nailed it. Now you own it.
Yes.
Or you can sell it as used.
There is a book, 2 printed inner sleeves, and a litho in this. So I apologize for the confusion when I was opening it.
All right. Litho this, litho that, litho with a baseball bat. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. That is what we wanted to highlight for you for Record Store Day.
I can't get the litho back in.
I told you, they get ruined immediately. Immediately they get ruined. All the time.
I didn't even have anything to drink in this episode.
Like, if you pull it out, then just put it in a frame and walk away. Or just toss it in the garbage.
But why would you want that frame?
I don't know. They say, well, it comes with a litho. But it's what they do. It's stupid.
Well, at least now that I open this, I can answer for myself when I put it on later if it's just Ragged Glory re-recorded.
There you go. So there's 387 releases this Record Store Day. So obviously we didn't. Hey, stop breaking shit. You motherfucker, you. Pow, ping, pow. Should I do
Dennis Smith? Dennis Smith's comment. Put it up.
Last time I listened to a Grateful Dead album, I stuck chopsticks in my skull. Yeah, I would too. Hey, wait. Here's Gene Simmons doing Joe Pesci. You motherfucker, you. Pow, ping, pow, pow.
What's happening, baby?
I'm laying here in the weeds, and he says, Bing, I thought I told you to go fuck your mother.
What's the line from Raging Bull? You're a sick fuck.
You sick fuck. You're a sick fuck. you mother... All right. I'm done with doing the Joe Pesci thing.
Please.
All right, we're going to move on to our last two segments here, and then we're going to call it a night. Thank you all for hanging out with us. All right, so we're going to go to Discovered, all right, where we discuss briefly a cover song that we like as much, if not more, than the original. Now, last time I think I went first.
You did.
So, Nick, you go first this time.
I went with a classic this week, Mike, because it came on the other day when I was playing through a couple CD sets in this here room. And I forgot about how much I love it. The cover of Cross-Eyed Mary by Jethro Tull by Iron Maiden.
Yes, that is a great cover.
Yes. And that I'm sure an I've picked cover. It before, but it's...
No,
a, it's
I don't
a,
think
it's
you a... have. I don't think you have. That cover is great. And if you haven't heard it, go on YouTube, Spotify, find it, whatever. It's a great cover. It was when they did a whole bunch of 12 inches when Seventh Son of a Seventh Son came out, and they released a lot of, like... This was at the time when printed CDs were like a rarity. So they had like a printing on every one of the CDs with its own artwork, unique artwork. They actually did a box set of all these 12 inches at the time.
The first 10 years, right?
The first 10 years box set. They made a box set of them. But for Seventh Son of a Seventh Son, there were like 3 or 4 or 5 different, you know, EPs that came out. Cross-Eyed Mary was on...
I thought it was on Flight of Icarus or something. I thought it was on.
No, it was later than that.
Are you sure?
I think it was later than that because they did so many around that time. I'd have to look.
No, dude. It's the B-side to the Trooper.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. I didn't realize it was that early. I thought it was later that came.
I'm verifying, but I could have swore.
Well, anyway, while he's looking that up, yes, it's an incredible, incredible version for sure. I agree 1,000,000% with that. For me, I went with a classic as well. I went with, and I don't know why, it just popped in my head as I was thinking about what is it this time. So I went with I Fought the Law by The Clash, which was originally done by Bobby Fuller. And Bobby Fuller's version is very happy, and the Clash's version is definitely a bit more trumped up. It is, I hate to use that verb or adjective, I should say. But still, the Clash's version is definitely, nothing wrong with the Bobby Fuller version. It's a great version of it. But I really like the Clash version. It is a better version of that song.
It is a great, they made it a classic.
Yeah.
The Clash did. It definitely was the beast. My Cross-Eyed Mary was definitely the B-side of the Trooper. Wow. Okay, that's confirmed. But here's something else confirmed, Mike.
What's that?
Listen to this. In a 2022 interview with Brave Words, Ian Anderson, that's the person most people think is Jethro Tull.
Yeah, because that's his real name.
Ian Anderson discussed discussed his thoughts about Maiden's cover, stating, "It's a spirited rendition by a young Bruce testing out his vocal range in a key not really suited to him."
Oh, wow.
That's quite a backhanded remark.
Yeah. That's as backhanded compliment as you could possibly get.
Yeesh. Oh, no. Did Clutch really do Cross-Eyed Mary? Is that true, Dennis?
I think they did.
That's awful. That's probably the worst. The only thing worse is how they did Fortunate Son, because that's two terrible things colliding.
I know how much you love Clutch, but I will say that Transnational Speedway League, that reissue that just came out, it sounds really good.
That's what a lot of people have been saying. So I'm glad. I'm happy for Clutch fans. You won't see one in my collection, though.
I know, but it sounds really good. Like the thump of the bass drum really helps drive that album. So, anyway, my turn, right? Wait, it is my turn because it is time for our favorite, our number one segment, the one that Nick likes the absolute best. This song sucks. All right, you know what? I should have started with the original, though. I'm still proud of that. I don't care. I'm still proud of writing that and recording that.
It's not better than Dumb News.
No. I mean, Dumb News is awesome. I'm gonna play the whole thing. But what about this one? I like that one better than Abracadabra.
I do too.
There's something about the flow of that one that just really resonates.
Can you do another one too with Center Field by John Fogerty?
Oh my God. I could.
That's another awful fucking piece of shit song.
Well, I got a couple of piece of shit songs that we could probably do these with this week. Now, I did just go see Billy Joel and Sting, and that informed my choice for this week. Now, you know, Billy Joel is an institution in Long Island, but they're not all zingers. All right. There are just
Please tell me you're going to pick Pressure.
No, I actually like Pressure. And Pressure actually has like it's actually basic root is rooted in classical music. It's actually classically influenced. I really dig it. But the song River of Dreams.
Oh, terrible.
Is just wow. I mean,
one of the worst songs ever.
He played it again. He played it live. And I'm like, I could have done without this. Like, this whole show was great, minus this. Like, he played Vienna. He played scenes from an Italian restaurant in My Life, Big Shot. And River of Dreams.
Oh, it's so bad. I hate how every time it comes around, how the stop gets longer.
Yeah.
Oh, I hate that. He thought he was so fucking clever.
He's not. Well, no. He is, but not on that song.
Not on that song, no.
No, I like literally, as I always say, if I never heard that song again, my listening habits wouldn't change.
Yeah.
That's how I feel about the Grateful Dead too. But you know that. By the way, the Grateful Dead does have another 4 LP box set. We didn't talk about it coming out of Record Store Day because they just need to milk this as much as possible.
They need to milk it. Yeah, they don't have any fans that buy their stuff. You're right.
Well, that's what I'm saying. They're milking it. I mean, aren't they all like pretty? Can much we go confirmed?
Back? Can we go back to River of Dreams?
Yes.
It wasn't that on his last.
It was
last,
on River of Dreams.
It was on his last record, though,
that
right?
Was
it
was the last studio album he did.
That's probably why, because somebody played him that pile of shit, and he was like, all right, I need to be done writing songs.
Yeah, but then he wrote a great song.
Yeah, with four other people. That's why it's great.
It's still a great song.
Yeah, but it's not because of him. He gave the last thing he did prior to Turn the Lights Back On was River of Dreams.
Have you seen the video the for tank, Turn the Lights Back On?
Yes. Yeah.
It's incredible. I do have to say, like, AI sucks for so many things and it could really fuck shit up. But that video is all done with AI. And
right.
You never know. And if you haven't seen it, it's like four stages of Billy Joel throughout his life. It starts with young Billy Joel and then moves on progressively throughout his life.
That vocal for the first two verses has to be AI too. There's no way he can still sing that like that.
No, that's right. Him. He did it live. He nailed it.
Then why in the last verse does he go down to like where there's no power?
It's a reverse emotion thing.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
That sounds like AI to me.
No, it wasn't. He wrote the song. He sang it just like that live.
They couldn't add anything in place to make it sound like he was singing it.
Stop.
I do love that song, but I don't love River of Dreams.
Thank you, Paul McCartney.
In the middle of the night,
I've been stabbing in my sleep.
It and you know, that song just sounds like The Lion King.
Yeah, anytime I hear that, I think The Lion Sleeps Tonight. I think of Ico Ico. I think of like all these other things that are way better than that song. It's just, yeah.
I hate that fucking song. That's a great pick. Can we just both pick River of Dreams?
Is that what you have? Is that what you? I don't think we could both pick the same song the same week. But you pick Abracadabra every week. So
coming next week, my pick for this song sucks will be River of Dreams.
Great. Okay. We don't even know when the next one's going to be. It's going to be late May because I'm on the road. You're busy. I'm busy. So it's going to have to be another month till the next one. But it'll be our 50th episode. So again, we're going to have special guests and maybe we'll have a giveaway.
Yeah, we got to have a giveaway.
By the way, if you're new here, go down and click the subscribe and the bell and like it and all those other things and make comments and tell, you know, everybody that it's awesome and tell my mom that she's cool because she watches and tell Nick's mom that she's cool because she watches. And, you know, I think my dad tunes in occasionally here and there, which is weird. Not because he's weird, but because, like, it's just weird to curse that much in front of my dad. So
my dad tuned in that one time. Remember when we had Gino Vanelli as the, I remember we had to decode. We're like, GFV, what is he talking about? And then we were like, oh, Gino fucking Vanelli.
Yep. And by the way, Gino is touring. He's out. He's going out there, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, we were all invited to his birthday party and you don't want to go.
I don't want to go to, no, I'm busy and I don't want to go to Illinois for his birthday. You know, he's playing in New York like 2 days before I get there.
Yeah, but it's not his birthday.
No, who cares?
You don't get to be invited to his special Q&A.
All right. So we should do a Gino Vanelli birthday episode mid-June.
Gino Vanelli birthday episode. Maybe we could get him on it.
Well, you know, Nick, when I wrote that song, it was, you know, I was in Montreal and I was thinking about all the nights in Montreal.
When me and Gall McCartney went running up to him and we're like, oh, we're like, Mr. Vanelli, will you sign our records? And he was like, yeah, no problem. And he signs them and he goes, what do you guys work here? We're like, no, we're here for the show. And he's like, really? We're like, yeah. He couldn't believe it.
You're not his demographic.
No.
Let's be honest.
No.
You're not his demographic. Neither am I for that matter. All I did was get drunk and stoned at his concert and start yelling stop at the top of my lungs, freaking out everybody in the row in front of me. I just wanna stop! And it was great. And everybody jumped. It was fantastic. All right.
You would do that too.
We did. We did. There was a few of us that did that actually. So it was fun. Oh, excuse me. Sorry. All right. You know what that means. It is time for us to say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye. thank you again for watching the show. My name is Mike. That is Nick. Nick, what store do you own?
Rock City Music Company.
And where are you located?
5 Mile in Farmington in Livonia, Michigan.
And where can we find you?
RockCityMusicCo.com and all social media platforms.
Awesome sauce. And what is your favorite album by David Cassidy?
The one that has I Think I Love You on it.
Well, that would be the whole Partridge Family, but okay.
Great record.
Judges?
PSA.
Yes, it'll count.
Hit that PSA. King's X at the Token Saturday. That's very important to mention.
And King's X at the Token this Saturday. You know Bob Tyrell will be there.
Yes.
Because he goes to every show everywhere in the Detroit area.
Yes.
And tell his dad happy birthday.
Yes.
It's funny. There's a picture of him and his dad on Facebook. He wishes dad happy birthday. I don't know who's who. And that's not saying anything bad against Bob. That's just saying that Bob's dad is incredibly young looking. But anyway, yeah. Okay, we're not starting the jingle again. Bye, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Record
again,
Store Day. Shop Rock
Record
City.
Store Day.
Wait, Mike. There's one thing we need to mention.
We're waiting.
If you do miss out on Record Store Day product, if you're not local to us, all of it will be available for purchase, or at least what's left, Sunday morning at 8 a.m.
Yes, there you go. Online?
Online. RockCityMusicCo.com.
There you go. All righty. There you have it. Later.
Bye.
And